Hello, Malty Molotovs. Ralfy here. It's rather noisy in this busy street. Excuse me. Traffic fumes. I'm in central London. That's St. James's Palace behind me. And Buckingham Palace is about half a mile away. It's a busy, busy old place, a very old part of the city of London. And what brings me here is this venue, Berry Brothers and Rudd Independent Bottlers of Fine Wines and Spirits, whose heritage and pedigree goes back several hundred years. So I've been invited in, because I was passing anyway for the rum show, to pop in, so I'm going to get away, the car's coming, to pop in and share a wee glass of whiskey. Now, what a wonderful opportunity to share that with you. Shall we? Let's go. This way. Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Good afternoon, Ralfy.
Fun seeing you here.
Bless you. Thank you very much for inviting me. I noticed that I didn't get escorted out your premises by the bouncers. Could I just say how enormously reassured I am? Obviously, my reputation, although it's not exactly squeaky clean, it's not that bad.
And then welcome, Ralfy.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Gentlemen, I've introduced Berry Brothers outside in the street and give us a place, the centre of London, St. James's. And I think that having mentioned to the malt makes about the antiquity as an independent family-owned wines and spirits company, which has never been incorporated, and my opinion, by the way, been depersonalised by corporate way of workings. I think it's very interesting to kind of just pop in, spend a bit of time with you, and we're going to discuss a fine old vintage whisky for the simple reason that there's many of you malt mates, you are probably familiar with quite a wide range of whiskies and other spirits that you can buy from retailers. However, you're probably looking at auction houses and seeing some of these much older whiskies, and you're wondering whether you should risk it for a biscuit, so to speak. And we have a bottle here, which I could, do you mind if I take this over and introduce it?
Of course, I've poured you a dram as well.
This is Ronnie and this is Johnny, by the way. Must introduce them properly.
Yep.
And they've poured me a wee dram. Here's the bottle. I can't hold it too near, it'll go all fuzzy, but that's about as near as I can hold it. Ronnie, could you give us an introduction from the label here?
Certainly. I mean, this is a typical Berry Brothers and Rudd label. It's got a picture of the old shop facade next door to St. James's Palace here in the West End of London. And typical of those days would have been we would select casks for people, and quite often we then start to bottle them as our own Berry Brothers brands. Prior to that, people would come in and perhaps select from two or three casks and have their own bottles filled. But this is very much later than that. This was distilled in December 1922, so very much the older style. And there weren't really a huge number of whiskies in those days, of course, that were very aged. This one is 18 years old, and it's typical of Berry Brothers and Rudd. We might have had the casks somewhere underground in London, before the days of having to bottle everything in Scotland now, as we do with malt whiskies. And they would have been possibly selected by the then nose of Berry Brothers and Rowden, put together in a way which would, they thought, appease the palates and nose of the then customers of Berry Brothers and Rowden. This one was particular. This one was actually bottled for our distributors in the United States of America, and distilled in 1922, which of course was during Prohibition. So it wouldn't have been able to be sold in the United States until the end of Prohibition, which happened almost 10, 11 years later. But then Scotch whisky became very popular in the States, and obviously there was a demand, and Berry Brothers and Rowden wanted to jump on that bandwagon.
Yes, of course.
So this is 18 years old, distilled in 1922, and of course the method of distillation in those days was very much slower than it is today. There was a lot of care taken, as there is today, but nothing was pushing it forward as it is today. And so the care and attention is reflected really in the spirit itself. And as I say, it was rare in those days to have something which was 18 years old. Mm-hmm. But what is manifest really on the front of the nose is that wonderful ethereal mango and sort of floral notes, oriental style on the nose.
I think it's worth pointing out that until you actually experience these whiskies, you really don't anticipate that one of the great properties of ethanol drinking alcohol is just how successfully it can preserve incredible complexity, not just in the nose, but on the palate over time. And I think sometimes as experienced whiskey drinkers, we must be thinking to ourselves, if we could go forward in time and drink some 500 year old or 1,000 year old whiskey, one, would it be palatable? Would it be drinkable? And the answer is probably yes. Completely.
Well, I mean, this was an interesting bottle. I picked this up from an American collector, and the level had already dropped into the body, so it's quite low. And the further the level drops on a bottle, the more likely it is that it's sort of just going to develop lots of off notes and over oxidize, and just sort of taste like cabbage. Mm-hmm. To be honest, so I was quite dubious when I bought it.
Yeah.
But a couple of things. It's bottled at 91.4 American proof. So that's 46% alcohol.
Yeah.
And I think that has kind of helped it hold up. And you can taste the character of this whiskey, you know, especially on the palate, it's quite peaty, that sort of old-style, turfy,
yes.
More kind of minerally peat, nothing sort of iodine-y, you know, kind of phenolic, kind of modern Lafroig or anything. It's quite mm-hmm. It's quite turfy.
Yes.
And that's one thing I've experienced sort of with older bottles, that, you know, if the ABV is quite high, even if the level's low, if it's that thick kind of peaty character of whiskey, it'll hold up quite well in bottle. Yeah.
Carrying on from what Johnny's saying there, it's worth noting that when you see bottles with a lower fill level in auction, the chances are that they're not going to necessarily appeal to collectors, and therefore they become more appealing to the whiskey drinker who's prepared to take the risk. What you've got to note though is that the chances are quite high that it's the alcohol, being a lighter molecular content of the bottle, which is going to seep from the cork over time, and therefore, as Johnny quite rightly pointed out, the fact that this has been bottled at a higher strength, if and probably is the case that it's the ethanol has lowered down even to 38 down to 36%, the actual integrity of complexity of flavour is going to be absolutely fine. But if you see a bottle, a really old bottle, it's even a third full, frankly, I wouldn't, at this point, looking at a bottle, the fill level, there comes a cut-off point, isn't there, where you just say, no, I'm not taking the chance.
Well, I think the other telltale sign, if the whiskey is cloudy, it's not going to be drinkable.
Yeah.
You know, I would take a punt on something. If it was higher alcohol and it was a bit lower down, but it was still clear, you know, maybe wouldn't shell out the same kind of money you would for a full bottle. But I think there's a, you know, it's always a good... If you take into account the alcohol, the style of the whiskey, and the fill level, and the clarity, you can take an educated guess, I think.
Righto. Now, gentlemen, for those who whiskey buffs out there who are interested in looking at what's available at auction, not just in Europe, but globally, primarily America now, because you're seeing more and more old bourbons and ryes appearing at auction,
What advice would you give, starting with yourself, Ronnie?
Well, I think when you look around, provenance, like in wine, is absolutely essential. If you can get provenance, i.e. buying it from basically a wine spirits merchant with great repute, the chances are that you've got something which is going to be probably more likely to be good than off. I think always with all these things, if you have a chance to be able to taste something similar to it and then take a chance on it, I think that's again another good angle. There's a lot of potluck in this, and I think the more you know about the old bottles, have a look at the label, obviously make sure that it's authentic, and you have to, to a certain degree, you have to just believe in yourself after, after experience. And it'll take you through. Sometimes you'll be disappointed, I'm afraid, and you know, people who buy old wines on eBay, for instance, think they're picking up a wonderful bargain, but actually don't know that that bottle has been lying on its side, or upright even, and in somebody's flat for the last 20 years of its life, and maybe completely ruined. And likewise, you know, if it's a corked, if a bottle has a cork in it and it's been on its side for some of its life, the cork will disintegrate. But worse still is that some of the disease from the cork, which in those days were not particularly good, I'm afraid, may have actually penetrated and corked the whiskey as well.
Yes.
It is a difficult one, but try and look at the label, look at the bottle, make sure that there are as many things that are as authentic as you can possibly judge, and then take the plunge. I think it's not an easy thing.
So I think you can still get bargains. You know, old blends are they can go either way, but you know, old White Horses you can still pick up for a reasonable. Mm-hmm. Reasonable price.
Of course, they would be quite heavy in the malt content in those days.
Yeah, again, it's one of these things that I've noticed with older blends, that the higher the malt content, I think the better they hold up in bottle. And
I agree.
It depends on the closure as well. I mean, I remember, and my friends will remember as well, I once opened a White Horse when we were across at Lagavulin, it was 1956 or something, and the level was fantastic, and it was, you know, still perfectly clear, and I was really excited about this bottle, but it was a spring cap. You know, the old sort of like
zinc spring caps. Nightmare.
Well, this tasted like someone had taken some whiskey and boiled a cabbage in it for a few days.
Yeah.
It was undrinkable. To the point that the chap there from Diageo asked to take it away for analysis. But, you know, that is a horror story, but often, you know, some old blends are absolutely phenomenal for the price. And even sort of old distillery bottlings from the 70s, you know, certain examples, the dumpy Glendronachs, the green ones, you can still buy them for, you know, reasonable money, and they are fantastic whiskey.
Wonderful. Can we just conclude, gentlemen? This has been absolutely fascinating. I hope you've enjoyed this little slight immersion in something that's a little bit different from the standard ralfy review. Naturally, this is not a bottle you can go out and buy. That's self-evident. However, they are out there. And depending where you are in your whiskey journey, or your rum, or bourbon journey, or your rum journey, they can pop up now and again. The advice from the gentleman here is really buyer beware, buyer take care, and to have knowledge and take your time at what you're looking at, and to do your homework before you take the purchasing decision is going to go a long way to help you avoid any serious mishaps. Now, gentlemen, just to conclude, could I have a topical handy tip, a nice rapid one for enjoying whiskey? One from each of you, starting with yourself, Ronnie.
Don't ever think you have to drink with somebody else. Try doing it by yourself and enjoy the moment. Enjoy the time that that whiskey was made, and just try and transport yourself back to the way in which it was made and the ethos behind the making of that particular dram.
Thank you. Johnny?
Interestingly, I was going to say the exact opposite. I was going to say, you know, ensure that, you know, you have these old bottles in your collection and it's nice to have them tucked away, and it's nice to put pictures on Facebook and see your lovely bottles. But, you know, life is short. Invite your pals around and crack them open.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Well, that's us. A little visit. A little. We'll conclude by, we're in an interesting little room here, Ronnie. Just a couple of minutes, if you could introduce the. What age is this room?
Well, we don't really know how old it is, but it's certainly as old as the building. And we're going back now to the 17th century, so the 1600s, around that time. And this room is considered to be the oldest room in this collection of buildings that belong to Berry Brothers and Rudd. And it was the office of the then chairman, up until about the 1980s, actually.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's very classy. Thank you for the invite, gentlemen.
Thanks for coming.
See you soon, mate mates. Bye-bye.